Hello everyone, welcome to this video. So since three videos we were discussing about the properties of Riemann-Stiele integrable functions, right? So now we shall continue that. So now we shall discuss the linearity property of monotonically increasing functions. So in that, the first property is, let f be a bounded real valued function on the closed interval a comma b, alpha 1 and alpha 2 be any two monotonically increasing functions on closed interval a comma b. If f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 and f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 2, then f will be Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2. And moreover, the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 1 plus Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 2. Right? So this is one of the property with respect to monotonically increasing function. Now we shall prove. So given f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 and f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to monotonically increasing function alpha 2. Now to prove f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2, we shall follow the Riemann criterion for integrability. So for every epsilon, we shall find a partition. So start with an epsilon, let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Now, since f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1, so for any epsilon, so there is a partition P1 of closed interval a comma b such that u P1 f alpha 1 minus L P1 f alpha 1 can be made less than epsilon by 2. And similarly, as f is also Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 2, so there is a partition P2 of closed interval a comma b such that u P2 f alpha 2 minus L P2 f alpha 2 can be made less than epsilon. So this is by Riemann criterion for integrability. Okay. Next, now we have two partitions. So P1 is a partition of closed interval a comma b. P2 is also a partition of closed interval a comma b. So take the union of P1 and P2. Then P will be called as common refinement of P1 and P2. Because P contains P1 and P also contains P2, right? So P is a common refinement of the partitions P1 and P2. So now if I use the generalized Riemann criterion for integrability, so these two conditions, so this conditions not only holds for the partition P1, but also for every refinement of P1. So generalized Riemann criterion says that, so if f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1, there exists a partition P1 of closed interval a comma b such that this condition not only holds for P1, but for every refinement of P1. So in place of P1, you can take any refinement of P1. So P is a refinement of P1. So this first condition holds for P also. That is U P F alpha 1 minus L P F alpha 1 can be made less than epsilon by 2. And once again, applying the same generalization for this condition, so this will be not only true for partition P2, but for all refinements of P2. So P is a refinement of P2, so that condition should hold for P also. So U P F alpha 2 minus L P F alpha 2 can be made less than epsilon. Okay, now we shall consider alpha 1 plus alpha 2.
So consider it as alpha. So define alpha of x to be alpha 1 of x plus alpha 2 of x. That is simply I have taken alpha 1 plus alpha 2 as alpha. Now, as alpha 1 and alpha 2 are monotonically increasing functions on closed interval a comma b, we observe that alpha is also monotonically increasing on the closed interval a comma b. So just to verify it, so when do we say any function is monotonically increasing? If x1 is less than or equal to x2, alpha of x1 has to be less than or equal to alpha of x2. So as the domain points increase, the function values should also correspondingly increase. So just to verify it, for any two points in the domain of alpha with x1 less than or equal to x2, as alpha 1 and alpha 2 are monotonically increasing on the same interval, so as x1 is less than or equal to x2, alpha of x1 will be less than or equal to alpha 1 of x2, and alpha 2 of x1 will be less than or equal to alpha 2 of x2. Then alpha 1 of x1 plus alpha 2 of x1 will be less than or equal to. So the first one will be less than or equal to alpha 1 of x2, and the second term will be less than or equal to alpha 2 of x2. But alpha 1 of x1 plus alpha 2 of x1 will be simply alpha of x1 by our definition, which is less than or equal to alpha of x2. Alpha 1 of x2 plus alpha 2 of x2 is alpha of x2. That is, for any x1 less than x2, alpha of x1 is less than or equal to alpha of x2, which shows that alpha is monotonically increasing function. Now, for this particular monotonically increasing function, we shall talk about the Riemann-Stiele integrability of f. So now we shall verify, is f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to this monotonically increasing function alpha, which is actually alpha 1 plus alpha 2. Right? So we have the partition P, which is actually a common refinement of P1 and P2. So as it is a partition, it merely contains finitely many points from A to B. So take those points as x0, x1, x2, so on up to xn. So now, to define the lower Riemann-Stiele sum and the upper Riemann-Stiele sum, we need delta alpha I. We shall calculate it. So what is delta alpha I? According to our definition, it is alpha of xi minus alpha of xi minus 1. But alpha of xi is alpha 1 of xi plus alpha 2 of xi. Alpha of xi minus 1 is alpha 1 of xi minus 1 plus alpha 2 of xi minus 1. Now, take all alpha 1 terms one side and alpha 2 terms one side. Now, alpha 1 of xi minus alpha 1 of xi minus 1 will be simply delta alpha 1 I, and alpha 2 of xi minus alpha 2 of xi minus 1 will be delta alpha 2 I. That is, for every I, delta alpha I is delta alpha 1 I plus delta alpha 2 I, where alpha 1 and alpha 2 are also monotonically increasing functions on the closed interval a comma b. And now we shall define the infimum and supremum of f of x on each subinterval xi minus 1 xi. Let small mi be the infimum of all f of x and capital mi be the supremum of all f of x as x varies over the subinterval xi minus 1 xi. Now consider the lower Riemann-Stiele sum of f with respect to the partition P and monotonically increasing function alpha. It is defined as summation small mi into delta alpha I. But for every I, delta alpha I is delta alpha 1 I plus delta alpha 2 I. So split the terms. So this term will be split into two terms. So mi delta alpha 1 I, mi delta alpha 2 I. So with respect to these two terms, so two summations can be split. So this summation, summation mi into delta alpha 1 I is nothing but lower Riemann-Stiele sum of f with respect to the partition P and monotonically increasing function alpha 1. And similarly, this one will be LPF alpha 2. That is the lower Riemann-Stiele sum of f with respect to the partition P and monotonically increasing function alpha 2. Similarly, we consider the upper Riemann-Stiele sum. UPF alpha is summation capital MI into delta alpha. Similarly, once again delta alpha is delta alpha 1i plus delta alpha 2i. So split the summation. So the first one will be summation capital Mi delta alpha 1i plus summation capital Mi delta alpha 2i. So the first summation will be simply UPF alpha 1. The second is UPF alpha 2. So we got two equations here. LPF alpha is LPF alpha 1 plus LPF alpha 2. And similarly, UPF alpha is UPF alpha 1 plus UPF alpha 2. So using these two equations, now we shall verify the Riemann criterion for integrability of the function f. So consider the difference UPF alpha minus LPF alpha. So UPF alpha is UPF alpha 1 plus UPF alpha 2 minus LPF alpha is LPF alpha 1 plus LPF alpha 2. Now take alpha 1 terms one side, alpha 2 terms other side. So UPF alpha 1 minus LPF alpha 1 plus UPF alpha 2 minus LPF alpha 2. So now using the equation 1, so by equation 1, so both can be made less than epsilon by 2. So the difference UPF alpha minus LPF alpha can be made less than epsilon, where P is any partition. So this shows that, so what we did for given any epsilon, we found a partition P of closed interval A comma B such that UPF alpha minus LPF alpha is less than epsilon. Hence, by Riemann criterion for integrability says that F has to be Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to monotonically increasing function alpha. But what is alpha? It is nothing but alpha 1 plus alpha 2. Hence, F is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to monotonically increasing function alpha 1 plus alpha 2. So which proves one part of the theorem. So now it remains to prove the integrable condition, integral Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 1 plus Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 2. So this is what remains to prove. So now to prove that, so just we shall recall a basic problem about supremum and infimum. Right? If A and B are bounded subsets of R, then so consider the set A plus B, which is the set of all sums A plus B, where A varies over the set A and B varies over the set B. Then we observe that supremum of A plus B, that is supremum of this set, will be simply less than or equal to supremum of set A plus supremum of set B. And similarly, infimum of A plus B, that is infimum of all these numbers, is greater than or equal to infimum of A plus infimum of B. So it is a very simple observation. So we know that supremum of A, so supremum of A means what? It is the least upper bound, or in other words, it is first of all a upper bound for all the numbers in A. So for all A in A, A will be less than or equal to supremum of A, as supremum of A is an upper bound of A. Similarly, supremum of B is a upper bound for the set of all elements in B. So B will be less than or equal to supremum of B for every element B in P. So now add these two inequalities, then A plus B will be less than or equal to, A will be less than or equal to supremum of A, B will be less than or equal to supremum of B. For all A varies over A and B varies over B. So as A varies over A and B varies over B, A plus B varies over all the elements of the set capital A plus capital B. That means every element of the set A plus B is bounded above by supremum of A plus supremum of B. In other words, I can say this number becomes an upper bound for all the elements of capital A plus capital B. So it is an upper bound, but the set of all elements A plus B have supremum. So supremum means what? It is the least upper bound. So this is the least upper bound and this is a upper bound. So least upper bound will be always less than or equal to any other upper bound. Right? In a similar way, infimum of A means what? It is the greatest lower bound of A. That is, it is a lower bound for all the elements of A. So infimum of A will be less than or equal to A for all A varying over A. And infimum of B will be lower bound for all elements in B, so that it will be less than or equal to every element of B. Now, summing up these two inequalities, A plus B will be greater than or equal to infimum of A plus infimum of B, where A varies over A and B varies over B. And as A varies over A, B varies over B, A plus B vary over all the elements of capital A plus capital B. That means every element of the set is bounded below by infimum of A plus infimum of B. That means we can call this as a lower bound for A plus B. And this set has the greatest lower bound. So infimum of A plus B, that is the greatest lower bound, is always greater than or equal to any other lower bound. So whenever we have two sets, two bounded sets for which infimum and supremum exist, then for the sum, supremum of A plus B will be always less than or equal to supremum of A plus supremum of B. Infimum of A plus B will be greater than or equal to infimum of A plus infimum of B. So just make it a point. So we shall use it in the next part. So now, to prove this integral condition, so we shall start with the Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha. So as it is, F is Riemann-Stiele integrable. So this integral will be nothing but the upper Riemann-Stiele integral of F, which is defined as infimum of all upper Riemann-Stiele sums, that is infimum of all UP F alpha as P varies over the partitions of closed interval A comma B. But UP F alpha is UP F P F alpha 1 plus UP F alpha 2. That is, we have infimum of the sum. So infimum of the sum will be always greater than or equal to infimum of UP F alpha 1 plus infimum of UP of alpha 2. So just now we have seen, so infimum of A plus B is always greater than or equal to infimum of A plus infimum of B. So just I am using here. So these, if I consider these are the elements of A and these are the elements of B, then it will be just infimum of A plus B. It will be greater than or equal to infimum of A plus infimum of B. But what is this? Infimum of all upper Riemann-Stiele sums of F with respect to alpha 1. It will be the upper Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 1. Similarly, infimum of all upper Riemann-Stiele sums of F with respect to alpha 2 is the upper Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 2. As F is Riemann-Stiele integral over alpha 1 and alpha 2, so these two integrals will be just corresponding Riemann integrals. That is, Riemann integral of F with respect to alpha 1 plus Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 2. So that we got Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha is greater than or equal to Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 1 plus Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 2. So this is what we get. Now on the other hand, similarly, consider the lower Riemann-Stiele integral of alpha, of F with respect to alpha. It is defined as supremum of all lower Riemann-Stiele sums with respect to alpha, but LP of alpha is LP of alpha 1 plus LP of alpha 2, what we have observed earlier. So once again now, if I collect all these lower Riemann-Stiele sums with respect to alpha 1 under the set A, and if I collect all these terms under the set B, then it will be simply supremum of A plus B. So it will be always less than or equal to supremum of A plus supremum of B. But what is this supremum? Supremum of all lower Riemann-Stiele sums with respect to alpha 1 is the Riemann-Stiele integral, the lower Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 1. And the second term will be the lower Riemann-Stiele integral of F with respect to alpha 2. And these two will be equal to the corresponding Riemann-Stiele integrals of alpha 1 and alpha 2, as F is Riemann-Stiele integral over alpha 1 and alpha 2. So we get another inequality. Now compare 4 and 5. So this is greater than or equal to this term, and also it is less than or equal to this term. So hence, by 4 and 5, equality holds. That is, the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha is the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 1 plus the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 2. So that is Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2, right? Alpha is nothing but alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is equal to Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 1 plus Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha 2. So just taking the definition of alpha here, we get the desired result. So which completes this theorem, right? One more property of a monotonically increasing function alpha. So the statement is, let f be a bounded real valued function on the closed interval a comma b, and alpha be any monotonically increasing function on the closed interval a comma b. If f is Riemann-Stiele integrable on closed interval a comma b with respect to alpha, and if c is any positive real, then f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to the scalar multiple of alpha, that is c into alpha, on the closed interval a comma b. And further, the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to the scalar multiple of alpha is the scalar multiple of the Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha. So which is a very easy to observe. So now we shall prove it. So what is given? So given f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to monotonically increasing function alpha on the closed interval a comma b, and c is any positive real. Now consider any partition p on the closed interval a comma b. Let p equals x naught, x1, x2, so on, xn minus 1, xn. Be any partition of the closed interval a comma b. And we all know that any partition of the closed interval a comma b will divide the closed interval into subintervals, right? So for example, if these are the points, then it is the closed interval a comma b can be divided into subintervals x naught, x1, x1, x2, so on up to xn minus 1, xn. So f is given to be bounded on the closed interval a comma b, so that f will be bounded on each subintervals. So as f of x values are bounded on each subintervals, its infimum and supremum exist. So we shall take those infimum and supremum as small mi and capital mi. So define small mi to be infimum of all f of x as x varies over the subinterval xi minus 1 xi, and capital mi to be the supremum of all f of x as x varies over the subinterval xi minus 1 xi. And we shall do this for every subinterval. Next, now since alpha is monotonically increasing on the closed interval a comma b, and c is a positive real, so if I consider the scalar multiple of alpha, the function c into alpha, so then it will also be monotonically increasing on closed interval a comma b. So first of all, so how we define scalar multiple of any function? So c alpha of x is defined to be c into alpha of x, right? So this is how we define scalar multiple of a function. Now, observing alpha is a monotonically increasing function, we are noting that c into alpha is also monotonically increasing function. So it is easy to observe. So for any two points in the domain with x1 less than or equal to x2, since alpha is monotonically increasing on close interval a comma b. So as x1 is less than or equal to x2, alpha of x1 will be less than or equal to alpha of x2, right? Now as c is a positive real, multiply c on both sides so that the inequality remains unchanged. So c into alpha of x1 less than or equal to c into alpha of x2. So what is it? It is nothing but c into alpha of x1 less than or equal to c into alpha of x2. So what is it? So that is nothing but saying the function c into alpha is monotonically increasing on the closed interval a comma b. So now we have f is a Riemann-Stiele integrable function on closed interval a comma b with respect to monotonically increasing function alpha. And now we have one more monotonically increasing function c into alpha. So now we shall check the Riemann-Stiele integrability of f with respect to this monotonically increasing function. So for that we need delta alpha I, that is delta c alpha I. So how we will define? So delta c alpha I is defined to be c alpha of xi minus c alpha of xi minus 1, right? So for every sub interval xi minus 1 xi, we define c delta c alpha I is c alpha xi minus c alpha xi minus 1. So what is it? It is c into alpha of xi minus c into alpha of xi minus 1, or c common, it is alpha of xi minus alpha of xi minus 1. So c into, so alpha of xi minus alpha of xi minus 1 is c into delta alpha I. So that is, we can observe that delta c alpha I is c into delta alpha I, which is true for all I from 1 to n. Okay, so now with this idea, now we shall consider the lower Riemann-Stiele sum and upper Riemann-Stiele sum. So consider the lower Riemann-Stiele sum of f with respect to the monotonically increasing function c alpha. So how we will define it? It is defined to be summation small mi into delta c alpha I running from 1 to n. But delta c alpha I is c into delta alpha I. So as c is constant, we can take it outside the summation. So c into mi delta alpha. But summations mi delta alpha is lower Riemann-Stiele sum of f with respect to alpha. So that is, we observe that LPF c alpha is c into LPF alpha. So call it as sum equation 1. Similarly, you can observe the same thing with respect to the upper Riemann-Stiele sum. So UPF c alpha, consider the upper Riemann-Stiele sum with respect to the monotonically increasing function c alpha. So it will be summation capital MI into delta c alpha I. So what is it? It is summation capital MI into, so delta c alpha I is c into delta alpha I running from 1 to n. So which will be equal to, so c outside, summation capital MI into delta alpha I running from 1 to n. So it will be c into capital MI delta alpha I summation. It will be UPF alpha. So that is, we observe that UPF c alpha is c into UPF alpha. So call it as sum equation 2. And now to prove that f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to the monotonically increasing function c alpha. So now to prove f is Riemann-Stiele integrable with respect to monotonically increasing function c alpha. So for that, we shall directly start with the lower Riemann-Stiele integral of f with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha. We shall show that it is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of f with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha. That is, we will show lower Riemann Stiele integral is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral. So, which is a necessary condition, or which is, it is a basic condition to say that f is Riemann Stiele integrable, right? So, consider the lower Riemann Stiele integral of f with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha. So, we define it to be supremum of all lower Riemann Stiele sums with respect to monotonical increasing function C alpha. But LP of C alpha is what? It is C into LP of alpha, right? So, now we have supremum of a positive real C into LP of alpha. So, where C is constant. So, we can take a positive constant directly outside the supremum. So, it will be C into supremum of LP of alpha, where P varies over the partitions of the closed interval A, B. We can do this only if C is positive. As C is positive, we can take it outside the supremum without changing the supremum condition. If it is negative, then by taking C outside, the supremum condition changes into infimum in the case of negative. Now, since C is positive, we have this. So, now C into, so now what is this? The supremum of all lower Riemann Stiele sums of F with respect to alpha. It will be the lower Riemann Stiele integral of with respect to alpha. But they have given that F is Riemann Stiele integrable of with respect to alpha. So, the lower Riemann Stiele integral will be equal to the Riemann Stiele integral of F. Now, once again, I'll use the same fact. So, as F is Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to alpha, so the Riemann Stiele integral will be equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral with respect to alpha. And how we will define it? So, it is defined to be infimum of all upper Riemann Stiele sums of F with respect to alpha, as P varies over the partitions of closed interval A, B. Now, once again, as C is positive, we can directly take it inside the infimum. So, infimum of C into UP of alpha as P varies over the partitions of closed interval A, B. Now, C into UP of alpha is UPF C alpha. Right, using the equation 2, I think, using the equation 2. Now, infimum of all upper Riemann Stiele sums with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha is simply the upper Riemann Stiele integral of F with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha. So, thus, we started with the lower Riemann Stiele integral and we end up with upper Riemann Stiele integral. So, therefore, the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of F with respect to the monotonical increasing function C alpha. So, hence, by the definition of Riemann Stiele integrable function, so we can say that F is Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to the monotonically increasing function C alpha. So, which completes a part of the theorem. Now, to prove the further condition, so we can use the same flow. Okay, now to prove the remaining condition, so we can use the same flow. So, we started with the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F with respect to the monotonically increasing function C alpha, right? So, further, so the lower Riemann Stiele integral of F is equal to, so I'll highlight this step. So, the left hand side is equal to, so this term C into F d alpha from A to B, and which is further equal to, just continue the flow, and finally it is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral of f with respect to the monotonically increasing function C alpha. So as f is Riemann Stiele integral with respect to the monotonically C alpha, so lower Riemann Stiele integral is equal to the upper Riemann Stiele integral, and further the common integral, so it is equal to C into f d alpha from a to b. So that is the Riemann Stiele integral of f with respect to the scalar multiple of alpha is equal to the scalar multiple of the Riemann Stiele integral of f with respect to alpha. So which completes the theorem. So in this video we discussed the two properties. So if f is Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 and Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 2, then f will be Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to alpha 1 plus alpha 2. So sum of the alpha 1 and alpha 2. And if f is Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to alpha, then f will be Riemann Stiele integrable with respect to any scalar multiple of it, provided C is positive. So these are the two things which we observed in this video. Thank you.